So my talk will focus on follow up on what Luciana has given about a case for Kenya, but you'll have a few backgrounds that will put the whole talk in context. Of course, we know that the world is being invaded by so many alien species, some of those that have become invasive in most countries. Of course, we know about Spodoptera frugivora, the fall armyworm, about Thamina absoluta, Tomatolef minor, and the Paracoccus marginatus. And most of these actually cannot be managed by chemicals. And the indiscriminate use and excessive use of these chemicals, especially in developing countries, in Eastern Africa, for instance, is not only eroding native biodiversity, but also it has implications on food safety. This talk focuses more on coffee berry borer, Hypothenemus hampei, which is native to Central Africa in the areas of Equatoria, and where the natural enemies that can manage this pest are actually best through parasitoids. So the best way of probably looking at this is more if you look at the pest invasion curve. Most of the initiatives to prevent, to manage most of these pests is through prevention of entry. And when it enters, you try to eradicate. If you have a very good early response, rapid response and early detection mechanism. Otherwise, the other one would be to contain so that you create pest-free areas and areas of low pest prevalence. But in most cases, most of these invasives actually establish self-sustaining populations, in which case that they have to be managed so that they do not cause so much harm to products. And that's what brings us to asset-based protection. And most of, under this is where you mostly have classical and augmentative biological control. So getting back to the to coffee berry borer, it is widely distributed, and it is a problem in Puerto Rico and Hawaii. And in the 1980s, USDA did pick some parasitoids from Eastern Africa. But over time, the population has immensely inbred, becoming less effective. So they need to reintroduce some of the wild species from areas where the parasitoids, where the pest is endemic. So it has a wide global distribution. It basically affects coffee arabica and coffee canifora, which is robusta coffee. It has an effect on yield and quality by boring the small green coffee berries, and this affects quality. And therefore, it's one of the main yield-limiting factors in Hawaii and Puerto Rico. So integrated pest management offers the most cost-effective mechanism, of course, where you have the parasitoid as part of that strategy. So there are basically three types of parasitoids, Cephalonomia stemphadoris, Prosopis nasuta, as well as Formica scofia, and all of these are found in the three counties in Western Kenya. So the project that this case study focuses on is strengthening capacity for the identification and rearing of coffee berry borer parasitoids in Kenya and biocontrol control in Puerto Rico. And it involves collection and provision of parasitoids by the providers, which is the government of Kenya and the local communities. And this project is supported by United States Department of Agriculture. So maybe getting back a little bit to what Luciana just talked about, of course, when you're going to get these parasitoids, these are genetic resources, so which are not exempted from the Nagoya Protocol. And I will not mention the objectives, she has mentioned them very well, but I'll focus on the third objective, which is fair and equitable sharing of the benefits arising out of the utilization of genetic resources. But also we have to be aware that Nagoya is not only the ABS mechanism out there. Luciana has talked about the International Treaty on Plant Genetic Resources for Food and Agriculture. And this one focuses majorly on 64 important food and forages, including maize, rice, oats, rye, and others. But not all of those are covered under the ITPGRFA. Those that are not covered under that, actually, legal access is given by the Nagoya Protocol. And also, I have to remember that when you are using some of those that are covered under the IPTJRFA, not for food, but outside food, such as plant extracts, for pharmaceuticals, for cosmetics, they therefore legal access to those that are covered under IPTJRFA is given by the Nagoya Protocol. So the international treaty only covers those 64 foods and forages if they're being used in the generation of food. Otherwise, outside that, then Nagoya Protocol is what covers them. So the Nagoya Protocol, was adopted in 2010. I won't go so much into the details. But the last one, it defines how genetic resources may be accessed and how users and providers reach an agreement on the fair and equitable sharing of the benefits arising from their use. And the new global biodiversity framework has goal number 3, which emphasizes the monetary and non-monetary benefits from the utilization of genetic resources. Luciana has talked about digital sequence information. The new framework extends the Nagoya Protocol to cover digital sequence information on genetic resources and of traditional knowledge associated with genetic resources as applicable, as shared, fair, and equitable. So this is going to have implications on the utilization of not only the physical resources in terms of parasitoids, in terms of the nematodes and so on, but where they are used for the digital sequence information in one way or another is used in biological control. So who is involved in ABS? You get the providers of the genetic resources, and these are covered under Article 3 of the Nagoya of the CBD, that states have sovereign rights over natural resources that are under their jurisdiction. Then you have the users. In most cases, these are the researchers, these are the farmers, who are responsible for sharing the benefits derived from genetic resources. Then you have the national focal points. These are institutions which are established by law. Actually, most of these countries, the Nagoya Protocol has been domesticated. In Kenya, this is under the Environment and Management Coordination Act of 2013, which details how access to resources will be done. And the same act that also nominates NEMA, the National Environmental Management Authority, as the national focal point that will facilitate access, that will provide information on details of contacts and requirements and processes for gaining access to those resources. Then you have the national competent authorities. This could be one body, there could be more bodies, which are established by government and are responsible for granting access to users of genetic resources and represent providers on local and national levels. For Kenya, which we're talking about, we have a number of national competent authorities. We have the Kenya Wildlife Services, which will give you access or grant you access to all resources in nature reserves and conservancies. You have the Kenya Forestry Authority, or Kenya Forestry Services, which grants you access to resources in forests. You have the Department of Veterinary Services that will give you access to animal resources. You have the Kenya Medical Research Institute, KEMRI, that gives you access to any human-related genetic resources. Then you have NACOSTI, the National Commission for Science, Technology, and Innovation, that grants you the research permit that you require to get that. So there are quite a number of national competent authorities. And then also you have, of course, it involves negotiating a prior informed consent by the provider, and then you develop a mutual agreed terms under which you're going to access those resources, and then a material transfer agreement, which will include monetary as well as non-monetary benefits. Some of the monetary benefits can include upfront payments, there could be milestone payments, there could be payment of royalties on commercialization of the products, on patents, on copyrights. There could be license fees, there could be special fees paid to trust funds, research funding, joint ventures, joint ownership of relevant intellectual properties, and so many others that will involve utilization of money. But also the non-monetary benefits include sharing of research and development results, authorship of publications, participation in development, product development, collaboration, training, and I think Christian has talked about this, as well as institutional capacity building, and so many other non-monetary benefits. So in this project, we mostly focused on the non-monetary benefits, and we've managed to do that through the training of scientists from the Kenya Cultural Research and Livestock Institute organization in a collection of the parasitoids, as well as mass rearing of those parasitoids as one of the non-monetary benefits. So who are the users? Based on that discussion we've had, what I presented, in our project, the users are the University of Hawaii, then Sen Cafe in Colombia, and then CABI International. Or CABI, we are part of the users, but also we act as intermediaries to ensure that we can bridge the government as well as that. So in this project, we are more of an intermediary, trying to ensure that we can help the providers and the users come together and get this project to work. So the providers are the county governments of Busia, and you can see them on the map. The one in green, then the county government of Kisii, which is in pink, and then the county government of Kisumu, which is in blue. And then CARO, which is the Kenya Cultural and Livestock Research Institute, is also a provider. And in this case here, Kenya Wildlife Service it helps to facilitate this process and also to witness it as well. So what is involved in accessing genetic resources in Kenya? One, you need a prior informed consent, as detailed in the Nagoya Protocol, but also as detailed in the Environmental Management and Coordination Act of 2013. Then you need mutually agreed terms, the terms on which the providers, in this case, these are the counties and the coffee farmers who are going to provide these parasitoids from their farms, what they expect from that. We've talked about the monetary benefits and also the non-monetary benefits. Although in this project, we are focusing on the non-monetary benefits because there are less monetary benefits that you're going to get from a parasitoid. Then you need a research permit from NACOSTI. I talked about that, one of the competent authorities. Then after you've been granted, after you've agreed your prior informed consent and your mutual agreed terms, NACOSTI grants you a research permit, which now allows you to do research on that very parasitoid. And after you've been granted that, then you go and get an access permit from NEMA. Now that will allow you to go to the field to collect the samples. And then when you've collected and you've done your mass rearing that you are doing, then you sign a material transfer agreement. And this is between the government of Kenya as well as the users, which would be now CABI, University of Hawaii, as well as Sen Cafe. And then the next is that after you've signed your material transfer agreement, you need to get a phytosanitary certificate. This is a normal procedure when you're moving such kind of materials, because USDA office won't accept them unless they have a phytosanitary certificate. So that is given to you by Kenya Plant Health Inspectorate Service. And then after you've got that, armed with your KEFIS certificate and the MTA, then NEMA grants you an export permit so that you can take your samples. So that's basically the process, how it happens in Kenya. We signed what you see on the extreme left. That was a prior informed consent that we discussed with the providers, that were the counties and the farmers. Then we entered a mutual agreed terms, and we had to provide this information, which is about the project and the other annexes that were required. We went ahead and we are granted a cost permit, as I've indicated. And we've recently been granted an access permit by NEMA. And now we've already, as we are working on all the others, we are also been drafting the material transfer agreement. The good thing that KWS has a template that you can adapt so that you don't go through many legal requirements, which we've adapted, and it has been accepted now. We shared it with all the users. They gave their input. KWS also gave their input, so we've sent it back to be granted permission to initiate signing. And most of this can actually be done concurrently as you are handling another activity. And this is one of the ceremonies we had when we had the agreements being signed by the those are the governors of the counties who were signing the prior informed consent, as well as the material, as well as the mutually agreed terms. So in brief, that is the process, how it happens in Kenya. Of course, signing the PIC and the MAT took us quite some time, because the process started pre-COVID, and then COVID came in. And then after COVID, we had the government changing. So when the government changes, then it means that you have to renegotiate with the current government again. So it really took us quite some time, but generally, it is a very well laid out process. Without those technicalities, we could be already done with this kind of process. Thank you very much.